We are presented as a team of teams, as an organization, as a species, as nations, with challenges as to why have we not, as of yet, moved the climate change resolution needle? Why haven't we developed solutions? Why we've known about this for close to 50 years. Climate change challenges have been an understood, on the horizon issue, something that we would need to face and work through. There was getting worse and worse, week by week, month by month, year by year. And we haven't faced it squarely, resolutely, comprehensively, in a well-organized, intelligent way. And there's a lot of reasons for that. And we've listed many of them. Buckminster Fuller created the Buckyball, which is a kind of basketball-shaped construct of bars and connected bars that make a sphere. And our metaphor, as we've been moving along, is to list, using the Buckyball metaphor, our process has been to utilize that to say there are tribal structures, tendencies, habits, and dynamics that have been holding us back as a species from resolving climate change and evolving as a species into higher consciousness. So if we want to let go of those previous tendencies and transcend their effects permanently in our world, we must delineate them, bring them to consciousness, and then discard them or transform them or transmute them or evolve them or learn our way through and out of them. So we're going to list three or four new, previously unlisted tendencies of humanity that tend to keep us from evolving and changing as a species, and that operate at all fractal scales and levels, whether in individuals, families, nations, organizations, and at the level of the species. So one of those, one arc in the Buckyball construct, is a subconscious decision-making switch that occurs at the root chakra level that looks at any situation of potential contribution or effect or application of our personal power or will or skill or capability and says, if I personally, if my ego, not my soul, if my ego and my body are not going to be here to see the benefit and the results of my personal efforts, then I'm not interested in doing it. I'm not interested in either participating or contributing, because that's outside the scope of the very narrow band of understanding and subconscious unconsciousness of the root chakra. So we at a subconscious level, we make a determination that it's not worth my time, it's not worth my effort or my resources or my energy to try to change something, for example, as big as climate change. It's not worth it to me to do so, because it might take longer than I'm going to be here for the fruits of my efforts to be realized. So I'm not going to see it, I'm not going to benefit from it, I won't be recognized for it, I won't get something for it. There won't be any what's in it for me. I won't get to experience it. So I'm just going to walk away from it and ignore it as a challenge for humanity. And thus I'm going to remain non-self-accountable. And thus the Titanic sails on, so to speak, towards the iceberg, metaphorically speaking. And I'm not responsible, and I don't even want to know, I don't even want to look at it, I don't even want to think about it, because if I do, then I would be required to make a choice to either admit that I was not doing anything or to do something and risk the possibility that I wouldn't personally gain as a result. So this very egocentric switch in the root chakra of humanity creates an obscuration of potential action for the well-being of all humanity and the well-being of future generations and the well-being of the planet itself. In effect, this switch turns off empathy, compassion, and love, and self-accountability, and even social accountability. So this, hopefully it's recognized as a very profound, fundamental, simplistic dynamic that occurs in humanity and is keeping us. It's one of the elements of the buckyball construct that are keeping us in the status quo, unevolved, not learning, not becoming self-accountable, not becoming resolutely empowered, not collaborating, not working together with others in order to create a better world for future generations and to become willing to heal the pain and suffering that the planet is enduring via our actions and ignorance and dismissiveness of its pain. This is not a criticism. This is a description of a dynamic that simply operates at global scale day after day after day for millions of years now. The next statement here is we hold a false assumption that somebody else is going to solve global problems for us. If we hold that assumption in any part of our systems, it will debilitate our capacity to take effective, constructive, resolute action and to work together as a collaborative conscious community in that endeavor. A lot of people are just not sure what to do. And this is another root chakra challenge, another buckyball limitation. It's a systemic limitation within human beings that says at the level of the root chakra, which is kind of our decision-making level of, am I going to take action or am I not? Am I accountable or am I not? Am I going to apply my power or am I not? So the root chakra limitation of not being able to understand something of scale or scope, meaning larger than my present moment of relationship or felt need or fear or lack or my personal beliefs or what is going to affect my near-term local environment. The root chakra doesn't have in its native form and dynamic, it doesn't have much capacity to willingly and intentionally and consciously envelop and evaluate the global process of planetary human life. And we can change that through conscious choice, and we can only change it through conscious choice, usually, if we first understand the limitation of the system, and then we choose to override it, take it off autopilot, and choose to become self-accountable global citizens. And then in that moment, we become quite sure of what to do because we recognize that we are accountable for our effect on the world and why we have it, when, where, how, and why we have that effect, what that effect is, and where we can potentially apply our energies and intentions and expertise to resolve global issues, again, in collaboration with others. Nobody's going to do, there's no individual in this world that's going to solve it all for everybody. And paradoxically, the ego wants to assume it either can or should be able to, and to try and to get some kind of compensation for that service. So social movement protest in the past, in its prior forms, has often been not an energy or process that was constructive or solution oriented. In some element of it, it's often been against something or not for something, rather than trying to generate a very clear goal, a very necessary result. And thus, many social movements in the past have had their energies absorbed and dissolved and counterbalanced by other tribalized energies that were just either against them or didn't support them or didn't understand them or didn't care. But we would suggest that it's helpful in any social movement to have a clear set of goals, to be well organized, well funded, very intentional, very conscious, very positive, not against anything, focused on generating something new, something more optimal, something healthier, something more constructive, something more aligned with spirit or with the common good or with the health of the world, so to speak. So human beings do not want to change their identity in order to have what they want or achieve and fulfill what they need collectively. They try to hold on to tribe and culture, belief systems, value systems, habits, wounds, dynamics of projection, prejudice, and bias. And they tend to do that for fear and pain avoidance reasons. And that process of trying to hold on to ego identity or tribal identity, social identity, ethnic identity, gender identity is imagined to be empowering, and simultaneously any positionality puts us against something or someone, some organization, some culture, some belief system, some way of thinking. And we would suggest that if we dispense with identity, that we become far more empowered, far more flexible, capable, and facilitative of supporting global change and transformation. In our understanding, for a new and sustainable life process to be arrived at by humanity, there must be a confluence of capacity, a coming together of collaborative effort and expertise and knowledge and resources in a well-organized way to support all facets and phases of the global transformational process in all of its current and future evolving and developing dynamics. If this confluence of this integrated multidimensional capacity doesn't occur, then we will continue to try to go about its resolution in a very hit or miss sort of way, in a very incomplete way, in a way that focuses on one dimension, one piece of the puzzle of the world to the exclusion of all others or to the exclusion of many others. If we were to say that just healing the emotions or the souls of everyone on the planet would somehow solve climate change, we'd suggest that that doesn't take into account, oh, and yes, everyone's still got to eat. They've got to have houses. They've got to have shelter. They've got to have safety, and they will want a way to express their creative capacities in the world. They want to have social process and dynamics. They want to feel fulfilled. So there are many, many other dynamics of life that must be taken into account. And of course, healing people's emotions and cultures is a vital key component of resolution of climate change and of generating a new life process for humanity.